A Shed Audio presents Among the Braves, written by Shibani Mahtani and Timothy McLaughlin, read by Jason Vu. To our mothers. In an age when it is so common for progressive, cosmopolitan intellectuals to insist on the near pathological character of nationalism, it is useful to remind ourselves that nations inspire love, and often profoundly self-sacrificing love. Benedict Anderson, Imagined Communities, Reflections on the Origin and Spread of Nationalism. Your Honor, the people of Hong Kong who took part needed no person or organization to incite them. If there was a provocateur, it is the regime that fired at its own people. Lee Chokian, former chairman of the Hong Kong Alliance in support of patriotic democratic movements of China. Prologue. Boundless oceans, vast skies. Tommy clumsily shuffled out of his sleeping bag, reaching over to rouse the friend dozing beside him before unzipping the small door of their tent and stepping outside. The soft sand of Ham Tin Beach, still cold in the pre-dawn darkness, shifted under his weight. The breeze carried his wavy, shoulder-length hair up in wisps, brushing a face framed by circular, thick-rimmed glasses, a defining accessory that he had worn since his teens. In front of him, the waters of Tai Lang Wan on the east coast of Hong Kong stretched out under the sky as it shifted from deep indigo to violet. In English, Tai Lang Wan translates to Big Wave Bay, and it often lives up to the name, producing swells that attract the city's contingent of surfers on holidays and weekends. But at that early hour, the strip of sand was quiet, dotted with colorful tents like Tommy's, and the water was relatively calm and empty. Tommy watched as a few sets of knee-high waves rolled in. Around him, other campers began to stir. The swish of nylon tents and hiss of propane stoves boiling water for instant coffee and noodles just audible. The campers chatted in hushed voices and stifled laughter, trying not to disturb those still sleeping off New Year's Eve over indulgences from the night before. For some years, Tommy and his friends had shared this tradition, camping out on one of Hong Kong's easternmost points, where they would be among the first to watch the New Year's sunrise. Here, surrounded by lush rolling hills, they found respite from their cramped apartments and towering public housing complexes and their overbearing parents. The night before, his friends had gathered a pile of brush and fallen tree branches and built a roaring bonfire. They clinked the green bottles of soju they'd bought at a convenience store before their hike. Their conversation, irreverent and meandering, lasted long into the night, the towering fire reduced to a pile of ash, embers flickering in the sand. What Tommy couldn't tell his friends was that this would be his final New Year's Day sunrise on Ham Tin. It would, in fact, be his last New Year in Hong Kong. In a few weeks, he wouldn't be staring out at the sea. He would be racing across it in a desperate dash for freedom in Taiwan. He tried not to dwell as the sky pinked, and he ambled back toward his tent to join his drowsy friends. Tommy took a mug full of warm water. He liked to refer to himself as a barista and believed he was above the instant coffee that his friends prepared, although his training as a coffee connoisseur was in a humble McCafe in a suburban shopping mall. It wasn't quite pour over or cold brew, but he did learn how to create latte art, making swirls and illustrations in the foam on customers' orders. Sometimes he'd practice making phallic doodles in the steamed milk. Warm drinks in hand, the early riser stood as the sun began edging over the horizon, just a sliver visible at first, and then filling the sky in its entirety. Sunrises and the new year symbolized a hopeful new start, but Tommy tried not to think of the one awaiting him. It made him queasy. Since middle school, Tommy had found peace in Hong Kong's vast country parks. The hills and beaches seemingly incongruous with the skyscrapers that most people associated with a global financial center. He had spent much of his free time exploring an extensive network of hiking trails that traversed the territory. Some snaked through the hills high above packed neighborhoods, and Tommy would peer down at the blocks of towers and ribbons of roads, wondering what they might look like in a decade or so. Others ran along the border with the Chinese mainland, where the modern high-rises of Shenzhen competed for stature with the peaks that Tommy climbed. Once a backwater, the city was now a physical manifestation of China's dizzying rise, symbolizing for many Chinese the kind of promise that Hong Kong once held. As the mid-morning sun rose higher, Tommy and two friends folded up their tents, strapped on their backpacks, and hiked to retrieve the car they'd left parked at the trailhead the night before. They chucked their gear in the trunk and made the hour-long drive south to Victoria Park, a 47-acre expanse of green space and sports facilities nestled in the popular Causeway Bay shopping district on Hong Kong Island. No excuse, not even their slight hangovers could keep them away. Hong Kong, at the start of 2020, was in its seventh month of a sustained citywide revolt against the Chinese Communist Party and its rule over the city. Tommy was a foot soldier in this movement, living a double life as both a carefree class clown and the black-clad protester, unidentifiable in the mass of fighters. By then, some 6,000 people had been arrested, including Tommy, twice. Police had fired more than 16,000 tear gas rounds, 10,000 rubber bullets, 1,850 sponge grenades, 2,000 beanbag rounds, and a handful of live bullets. But the movement persisted. On that New Year's Day, the veteran protest organizers who stunned the world with their million-strong marches had called for people to turn up again in the afternoon at Victoria Park. The Civil Human Rights Front was an organization now synonymous with Hong Kong's larger civil society, and it wanted to set the tone for the year. The organizers did everything by the book, applying for a police letter of no objection to hold their demonstration, consistent with laws in Hong Kong meant to preserve free speech, the freedom of assembly, and the right to peaceful opposition. These were the fundamentals that, more than the Shenzhen border, set the boisterous city apart from the mainland. Tommy sat in the backseat. The car was not his. He couldn't afford one as a second-year visual arts student. His parents, a cook at a local restaurant and a part-time car wash attendant, didn't own one either. His friends sped across the hinterlands, known as the New Territories, named for when the British took even more land from China in 1898, onto the highways of Kowloon and under Victoria Harbor. The wild country parks gave way to village homes and low-rise buildings. Then, towering apartments and skyscrapers formed angular blocks under the blue sky. For most of Tommy's life, these landmarks had seemed largely meaningless. But now some were imbued with memories of tear gas-shrouded battles between his compatriots and the Hong Kong police. There was Polytechnic University, besieged by the police several months earlier. The police headquarters in Wan Chai, which he had pelted with eggs before he knew how to mix a Molotov cocktail. As the car sailed down Harcourt Road, Tommy remembered the asphalt, stained with blood and littered with broken gas masks. The remnants of a violent mass arrest that had ensnared him. The group cursed as they crawled through the streets around Victoria Park, struggling to find a parking spot. Clusters of people, almost all dressed in black, were filling the sidewalks, some spilling into the streets, weaving between traffic. Tommy checked his phone obsessively, scrolling through a stream of messages and toggling between groups on the encrypted messaging app, Telegram. Thousands were posting updates in different channels, locations of police vans and riot officers, subway delays, and possible emergency exit routes from the park. They finally spotted a parking garage and guided the car into a space. The group jumped out. Tommy looped a black surgical mask around his ears and slipped into a small opening in the thronging crowd. The surgical mask was part of the uniform of protesters, keen to stay anonymous even before a mysterious new virus from Wuhan would prompt worrying them for an entirely different reason. This was a seasoned movement by January 1st, 2020, and everyone had their role. There were the braves, like Tommy, frontliners who strategically vandalized businesses owned by Beijing supporters, snuffed out tear gas canisters, and threw them back at police, and took on officers, beating them with rods and sticks at the risk of certain jail if arrested. Behind them were the Huli Fei, or Wo Lei Fei, Cantonese for the peaceful, rational, and non-violent crowd. Those who held banners and shouted slogans, they often had their kids in tow and avoided conflict. There were those operating behind the scenes, organizing gear, supplying snacks and bottles of water, and providing transport at the end of marches. Together, they had spent the past months united, presenting the Chinese Communist Party with the greatest challenge to its rule on Chinese soil since the Tiananmen Square protests of 1989, in a city that was meant to be placated and subdued by wealth, too seduced by the trappings of modernity and glitz to ever rock the boat. The discontent started in the spring of 2019 with a proposed bill.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.